None better than him. Today I want to talk to you about the cradle, the cross, and the crown. A recent cover of Life magazine featured a portrait of Jesus with his soul-searching question, "Who do you say I am?" A personal question that all of us need to answer. And the way we answer that question determines our faith and our values and our destiny. It is understanding who Jesus is, his person and his work, that gives meaning to his miraculous birth, his sinless life, his incomparable teachings, his miraculous wonders, his atoning death, his triumphant resurrection, his glorious ascension, and his promised return. The day Jesus first asked that question was to his disciples. And the Bible tells us that Peter spoke up first and answered the question for himself. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 15, "Who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus went on to say to him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." And I pray that you too will receive a revelation of who Jesus is, that you too come to the place in your life to say you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Understanding the person and the work of Jesus can be seen in three dramatic scenes in his life: the cradle of his incarnation, the cross of his salvation, and the crown of his exaltation. The life of Jesus begins in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, in the cradle of his incarnation, born in a manger wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. What a strange place to find God, lying in a manger. The incarnation of Jesus, the word incarnation means that he became flesh, he became human. He shared our humanity, as Hebrews 2 and 14 says. He shared our humanity because he is in his nature divinity. Divinity took upon humanity, the incarnation of God. Jesus is not merely godly or godlike. He is God, the Son of God. Jesus is not a man who became a God. He is God who took on the form of a man, the incarnation of divinity is the miracle of Christmas. It is the divinity of Jesus that sets him apart from all religious figures in history. Jesus is more than a teacher, more than a prophet, more than a good man, more than a messianic figure. He is, as the Apostle Peter said, the Son of God, one with the Father, coexistent, co-eternal, co-equal with the Father and the Son. Jesus is called the Son of God 49 times just in the four Gospels. And this is what Isaiah was talking about prophetically when he said of the coming Messiah in Isaiah 9, verse 6 and 7, "His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." This is what the angel told Joseph when he appeared to him in a dream. In Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, "His name shall be called Emmanuel," which being interpreted means God with us. This is what Gabriel told Mary when he visited her and told her that she would give birth to this child. And she said, "How can this be?" Luke chapter 1, verse 35, the angel said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." And this is what John was trying to communicate, one of those 12 apostles, John the Beloved, who was with Jesus in his ministry and wrote that beautiful gospel. And he begins it in such a unique way to introduce Jesus to the world. He calls him the Word of God. That's the Greek word logos, because that word the Hebrew scholars understood and the Greek philosophers. The Word of God, the logos of the Greek philosophers, was the reason behind the existence of the universe. They saw that as a term that was a bridge between God and man. The Jewish rabbis used it in the same way. Logos in Jesus' day was a Greek word that they used to refer to God himself and would describe the logos as the incarnation of the wisdom of God to humanity. And so Jesus was called the Word of God by John because he knew this was a word that both cultures were familiar with. And he said, if you want to know the reason behind the universe and the power of the universe and the bridge to God and the revelation of God, look at Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, Jesus, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and his life was the light of all men. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness could not conquer it. Verse 14, the Word became flesh, incarnation. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we behold his glory, the glories of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And this is what Paul was trying to tell us about Jesus in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 through 18. He says that he, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him were all things created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things are created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. It's what the writer of Hebrews was trying to help us understand about the divinity of Jesus in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. He said, the Son of God is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. In other words, holding the very universe together. This is a miracle of miracles that the one in the manger created the universe. Scientists tell us that the universe consists of time and space, matter and energy, and the laws that govern it. They estimate that the galaxy in which we live, the Milky Way, is 100 million light years across. Our galaxy contains 100 billion stars. If you start counting today, it will take you 3,000 years, nonstop speaking, to count to 100 billion. In fact, you wouldn't live long enough to count to 1 billion if you started the moment you were born. And our galaxy alone has 100 billion stars. The next galaxy, if you're interested in traveling, the Andromeda Galaxy is 2.5 million light years away. The closest star to us is Alpha Centauri, 4.5 light years away. And if you're interested in traveling, just so you know, one light year is 6 trillion miles. A galaxy that's 100 million light years across has 100 billion stars. And Isaiah 40, verse 26 says that God calls the stars out and calls them all by name. And Paul the Apostle tells us that the one lion in the manger created all things visible and invisible. Not only did he create all things, he created them by his power and holds them together by his powerful word, the incarnation of God. God who stepped into human experience, who shared our humanity. As man, he was born of a virgin. As God, he's from everlasting to everlasting. As man, he spoke in parables. As God, he spoke the worlds into being. As man, he walked through the streets of Jerusalem. As God, he walked upon the water, and the winds and the waves obeyed his voice. As man, he was hungry, but as God, he said, I'm the bread of life. His man, he was thirsty. As God, he said, I'll give you to drink living water that you know not of. As man, he was tired, but as God, he said, I'll give you rest. As man, he was tempted, but as God, he knew no sin. As man, he prayed, but as God, he answered prayer. As man, he wore a crown of thorns. As God, he's crowned with glory and honor. As man, he died on a cross. As God, he died for the sins of the world. As man, he was laid in a borrowed grave. As God, he rose on the third day. As man, he appeared to his disciples. As God, he returned to heaven as our great high priest. Christmas is about the miracle of the incarnation of God. Who do you say I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. But the cradle is destined for the cross. It is at the cross where the work of the Messiah was accomplished. Christmas points to the cross. Unto us a child is born, Christmas. Unto us a son is given, that's Calvary, where God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The cross of salvation. And that's what the world needs. The world doesn't need another prophet. The world needs a Savior. And that's the whole reason Jesus came, to save us. The essential truth of the Christian gospel is the doctrine of salvation. That's what it tells us in Matthew 1, verse 21. The angel told Joseph, you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Anybody need to be saved here today? Saved from guilt, saved from fear, saved from judgment, saved from wrath, saved from loneliness. There are many religions in the world, but one Savior. Jesus came to save us, and salvation happened at Calvary. On the cross. In fact, the book of Hebrews chapter 9 tells us in the atonement of Jesus for the sins of the world. That word atonement means to cover our sins and to take away the wrath of God against sin. It tells us that Jesus died once for all. Once for all people. Once for all time. Once for all sin. I saw a rally in downtown Atlanta when I was in college. And some guy was holding up a sign that said, Jesus died for somebody's sins, but it sure wasn't for mine. And I said, yes, it was. Once for all time, once for all people, once for all sin at Calvary. We could talk today about the prophecy of the cross. Isaiah saw it hundreds of years before it happened in Isaiah 53, verse 5. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. By his stripes we are healed is quoted in Matthew 8, verse 17, as a description, explanation of Jesus' healing ministry. It is quoted in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. The apostles understood the messianic prophecy of the cross. We could talk about the preordination of the cross. Before God spoke the universe into being, God decided that Jesus would provide atonement. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, it says, you were redeemed not with perishable things such as silver or gold from your empty way of life. You live in an empty life today, there's a way out, but you're redeemed by the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect, who was ordained before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times. For you, he came at just the right time. Galatians 4, verse 4 says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. The prophecy of the cross predicted the preordination of the cross by the determinate will of God. The purpose of the cross, we could talk about that Jesus always saw that as his essential mission. He didn't see prayer as his main mission or teaching parables or even working miracles. Those were all pointing to something greater. He said in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. We could talk about the place of the cross where it happened, and I have stood outside of Jerusalem myself on that sacred hill somewhere up there with those Romans crucified people. They call it Golgotha, which means the skull, or Calvary in the Latin. The skull, the place of crucifixion. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 12 said Jesus suffered outside the city gate that he might make the people holy with his own blood. We could talk about the power of the cross. People stand in awe of its mystery. Don't understand it, we say to ourselves. And Paul writes about that in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are saved, it is the power of God. We could talk about the peace of the cross, that we are at enmity and odds with God because of our sinful nature, our rebellion against God. But Jesus made peace and restored us to the Father. Colossians 1 verse 20 says that Jesus made peace by his blood shed on the cross. But I prefer to talk to you about the perfection of the cross. So when Jesus died, the last words he uttered, according to John chapter 9 verse 30, were these words, "It is finished." And we don't have to go to a confessional booth, and we don't have to go to a priest, and we don't have to offer a sacrifice, and we don't have to keep a Sabbath regulation, and we don't have to follow traditions of the church. It is finished. The work of salvation was finished by Jesus. We don't need to work our way toward heaven. Jesus did the work for us. And the passion of his cross, you say, what really happened at Calvary? The great exchange happened. God took something from us and gave us something from himself. 2 Corinthians 5 and 20. God made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. At Calvary, he took our alienation and gave us his atonement. At Calvary, he took our brokenness and gave us his blessing. At Calvary, he took our chastisement and gave us his cleansing. At Calvary, he took our debt and gave us his deliverance. At Calvary, he took our emptiness and gave us his empowerment. At Calvary, he took our fear and gave us his forgiveness. At Calvary, he took our guilt and gave us his grace. He took our hopelessness and gave us his holiness. He took our iniquity and gave us his intercession. He took our judgment and gave us his justification. What really happened at Calvary? He took us out of the kingdom of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of light. At Calvary, he took our loneliness and gave us his love. At Calvary, he took our mistakes and gave us his mercy. He took our nothingness and gave us his nobility. He took our oppression and gave us his overcoming power. He took our penalty and gave us his peace. He took our questioning and gave us his quickening. At Calvary, he took our rejection and gave us his redemption. He took our shame and gave us his sanctification. He took our tragedy and gave us his triumph. He took our unworthiness and gave us his unmerited favor. At Calvary, he took our vices and gave us his victory. He took our waywardness and gave us his wisdom. He took off of us the yoke of bondage and gave us a yoke that is easy and a burden that is light. At Calvary, he took our zeal for the things of this world and gave us the zenith of his love at Calvary. That's where salvation took place. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross with the dearest and best, for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it one day for a crown. The cradle of incarnation, God who shared our humanity. The cross of salvation, we atoned for the sins of the world, and God pardoned the world. You're forgiven. Come to Calvary and receive it. Be cleansed. Calvary's the place where old things pass away and all things become new. Calvary's the place where grace and law have met together and been reconciled. Calvary is the place where grace and mercy flow freely to the world. And then there's the crown of his exaltation. The summation of the person and work of Jesus is found in the words of Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. Therefore, because he is divine, therefore, because he was born of the Virgin Mary through the miracle of God, therefore, because of his sinless life, therefore, because of his atoning death, therefore, because of his glorious resurrection, therefore, because of his ascension to heaven, therefore, God has highly exalted him and has given him the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father, that is the Christian confession, Jesus is Lord. 3 days later, the tomb was empty. Romans 14 and 9 said, Jesus both died and came to life again, that he might be Lord of the living and the dead. Jesus reigns from heaven today. This world is not spinning out of control. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 25, that Jesus must reign until he's put all of his enemies under feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Revelation 11, 15 says, now the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And Jesus in his exaltation will return again. When he was caught up to heaven at the Mount of Olives and he disappeared from the disciples, they were standing there looking into the sky. And the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 1, verse 9 through 11, that suddenly two men dressed in white, angelic beings, said, you men from Galilee, what are you sitting here gazing up into the sky? This same Jesus who was taken up from into heaven will come again as you have seen him go into heaven. Who do you say I am? Jesus asked. Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. When I think of the glory of Jesus, and that's what Christmas means. It means Christmas, the celebration of Christ. And that's what this service is about today. It's the celebration of Jesus. It's pointing the world to Jesus. It's pointing believers to Jesus. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. When I think of the portraits of Christ, I cannot help but think of the way I have seen him in the scriptures, all the prophecies of the Old Testament, the types and the shadows, the stories, the illustrations, all point something of the glory of Jesus. I've found him in every story, in every book, every line of the Bible. In Genesis, he's the seed of woman. In Exodus, he's the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he's the high priest. In Numbers, he's the smitten rock. In Deuteronomy, he is the prophet. In Joshua, he's the captain of the Lord's host. In Judges, he's the great and final judge. In Ruth, he's the heavenly kinsman. In Samuel, he's the anointed one. In Chronicles, he's the temple and the glory of God. In Kings, he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Ezra, he's the teacher come from God. In Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of broken lives. In Esther, he's the protector of his people. In Job, he is the creator. In Psalms, he is the good shepherd. In Proverbs, he is the wisdom of God. In Ecclesiastes, he is the preacher who unravels the mystery of life. In the Song of Solomon, he's the bridegroom coming for his bride. In Isaiah, he's suffering servant and conquering king. In Jeremiah, he's the potter who shapes the clay of our lives. In Lamentations, he is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he's the wheel in the middle of the wheel, the center of all things. In Daniel, he's the Son of Man coming in clouds with power and great glory, and his kingdom will never end. In Hosea, he is the love of God for the backslider. In Joel, he's the baptizer with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he's the altar of judgment and of mercy. In Obadiah, he is the God of retribution. In Jonah, he's the salvation of the Lord. In Micah, he is the great intercessor. In Nahum, he's a stronghold in the day of trouble. In Habakkuk, he is the God of mercy. In Zephaniah, he's the restorer of all things. In Haggai, he's the desired of all nations. In Zechariah, he is the branch of Jehovah. In Malachi, he is the Son of righteousness, rising with healing in his wings. Who do you say I am? In Matthew, he's the kingly Messiah. In Mark, he's the miracle worker. In Luke, he's the great physician. In John, he's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. In Acts, he's the risen Lord. In Romans, he is our justification. In Corinthians, he's our sanctification. In Galatians, he's our liberation. In Ephesians, he is our peace. In Colossians, he is our perfection. In Philippians, he is our joy. In Thessalonians, he's the coming Lord. In Timothy, he's the judge of all men. In Titus, he is the redeemer. In Philemon, he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. In Hebrews, he's the author and the finisher of our faith. In James, he is the healer of the nations. In Peter, he's the chief shepherd and the bishop of our souls. In the letter of the apostle John, he is the word of life. In Jude, he's coming with thousands of his holy ones to execute justice on this world. And in the Revelation, he's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last, the line of the tribe of Judah, the root of Jesse, and the offspring of David. He is the faithful and true witness, the firstborn from among the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth. He's coming again at the end of the age. Written upon his robe and upon his thigh are these words: King of kings and Lord of lords. Who do you say I am? Jesus asked. It is my prayer that if you don't know him, whether you're religious or unreligious, that you'll look to this one, the Savior of the world, to believe in him that you might have eternal life. If you're a Christian and you get distracted by the things of the world, or you get distracted by spiritual forces, I pray that you'll, at this Christmas season, put your eyes back on Jesus and remember that being a Christian is about following Jesus. It's about a devotion to Jesus, not an idea, not a system, not a doctrine, but a devotion to the living Lord himself, where he walks by your life one day and says, come follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Where he comes by your life and says, if you really want to find life, deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow me. And Jesus says, I'll give you life and life more abundantly. Christmas is the celebration of Christ. And I pray that in your own heart, you can answer the question he asked you today. Who do you say I am? That you will come to the place in your life where you say you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Would you join me for prayer this morning? Lord Jesus, what words could I ever compose or proclaim to tell others really the wonders of who you are? But I pray by the Spirit of God today, they may catch a glimpse of you, Lord Jesus, and the wonders of your person, to come to see you, to know you, to love you, to believe in you. And I pray, Lord God, that you'll empower your church in this generation to never get distracted by things going on in the world or by worldly endeavors, but to be faithful, to lift up the name that is above every name, that all the world may know Jesus saves. I pray that during this Christmas season, you'll bless this great Mount Perrin family. Bless their individual homes. I pray that your glory will fill every house and every heart. I pray, Lord God, that you will visit them once again with your presence this Christmas. We worship you, Lord, today in spirit and in truth. If you believe in him, why don't you whisper in your own heart today, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you for joining us today for worship. What an amazing service today we've enjoyed in the presence of the Lord during this Christmas season. If you've accepted Christ your Savior, you want to know more about becoming a Christian, let us send you a copy of Fresh Start, help you understand everything about following Jesus as Savior. Christmas is the greatest season of the year. Now this week, very important services coming up. I want to invite you personally to join us for Christmas Eve candlelighting services, 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock p.m. on campus and also online. There's one advantage to being on campus, however, if you're able to be here, and we're going to give stockings of candy to all of the kids on campus. So it's a great service for everyone. Make sure you invite others. Christmas Eve, 5 and 7, the beautiful candlelighting services. Beautiful worship, the choir, the orchestra, I'll be bringing the Word of God. The candlelighting ceremony is unbelievable. Now, next Sunday, because of our holiday schedule, we will worship at 10 o'clock online and begin at 11
on campus at 10 a.m. Just a little bit of schedule change. Please note the schedule change. We're looking forward to a great Sunday as well. I trust that you will be present in worship. I love you. Appreciate your commitment to the ministry. And if you haven't checked out Refresh Our Campus program and the offering that we're raising for the end of this year, please go online, check out Refresh Our Campus. Pray about how you can participate financially to help us make this new investment going forward in our ministry together. I want to thank all of you who've already responded in pledging and giving for next year's project. And I'd like for all of you to see what we're doing. I know you're going to help out as well. Just check out, make sure we get you the packet because it has my new book, God as a Gift for You. I think you'll enjoy reading it as well. So check out Refresh Our Campus. I'm looking forward to see you for Christmas Eve as we worship our Savior. God bless you. Merry Christmas.
Come and see what God has done. child prays for peace on earth, and she's calling out from a sea of hurt. Oh come, Emmanuel. And can you hear the angels singing? can't stay.
Baby, it's cold outside.
I got to go away.
Baby, it's cold outside.
This evening has been
hoping that you'd drop
so
in.
Very nice.
I hold your hands, they're just like
my
ice.
My mother will start to
beautiful,
worry.
What's your hurry?
My father will be pacing the floor.
Listen to the fireplace
so
roar.
So really I'd better scurry.
Beautiful, please don't
but
hurry.
Maybe just a half
I'll
a drink
put
more.
Put some records on while I pour.
The neighbors might
baby,
pay.
It's bad out there.
Say what's in this
no
drink.
No cap to be had out there.
I wish I knew
your
how.
Your eyes are like starlight
to
now.
To break this spell.
I'll take your mm-hmm. hat, your hair looks swell.
I ought to say no,
oh,
no,
mind
no,
if
sir.
I'm moving closer.
At least I'm gonna say that I tried.
What's the sense in hurting my pride?
I really can't
baby,
stay.
Don't hold out. Cause baby,
it's cold outside.
Outside.
The answer is
oh,
no.
Oh, baby, it's cold outside.
No, no. Your welcome
how
has been
lucky that you dropped
so
in.
Nice and warm.
Look out the window at that storm.
My sister will be
oh,
suspicious.
Gosh, your lips are delicious.
And my brother will be there at the
waves
door.
Waves on a tropical shore.
My maintenance mind
oh,
is
gosh,
vicious.
Your lips are so delicious.
But maybe just a cigarette
oh,
and more.
Such a blizzard before.
I got to get
but
home.
Baby, you'll freeze out there.
Say, lend me
oh,
your
up to your knees out there.
You've really
I'd
been great.
When you touch my
but
hand.
You don't see.
How can you
no,
do
no.
this thing to me?
It's bound to be talk tomorrow.
Think of my lifelong sorrow.
At least there will be plenty in black.
If you've had pneumonia and
but
died.
I really can't
get
stay.
Over that hold out.
Oh,
thank you.
is to write on
in a world of open flame. Hey, 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 hey.